Okay, guys, we're going to try to kick this off. As it's customary to ask everybody to switch off or turn your telephones on vibrate out of respect to our guest. I have the pleasure of introducing Stelarc as part of this continued lecture series that's been curated by my brother and myself as a kind of follow-up to an exhibition and an idea about enabling that we were looking at, which is in respect to ideas of art, architecture, design, and performance as a kind of mode of inquiry, as an introduction in terms of ideas of social engagement, questioning of technology, art, and just generally speaking, idea of design as a form of interrogation. Leading up to Stelarc, we had Krzysztof Wodycko, social political activist, and John Fraser. And in continuing the series, I don't think that there's an individual who has been exploring technology, the issues to deal with body politics, ideas of robotics, bio art, in terms of defining the role of how Stelarc has sort of played in many of the kinds of fields. It's very difficult to sort of introduce him with doing justice, I think, to the varied sort of research and applications that he's been exploring. I think one thing that Stelarc, I think, is a testimony of is this kind of inquisitive nature about looking about the limits of the body, thinking and conceptualizing the body as a form of obsolete technology, and how this kind of spawns a whole series of different kinds of projects that are all sort of trying to ask new questions about a very particular condition that also looks at the humanity of technology and its application. With this, Stelarc obviously has a series of distinguished titles and degrees. He is a researcher in many institutions, most currently a chair in performance at Brunel University, which is a local UK institution. With this, I'd like everybody to warmly welcome Stelarc to the AA. It's been 5 years since he's been here, and it'd be great to actually have him back. With this, I give you Stelarc.
Thank you. Thanks, Theo. I guess this is going to be more a presentation on bodies than on buildings, but these projects explore alternate anatomical architectures, sort of chimeric structures of meat, metal, and code, the ways of hybridizing the body and generating it as an extended operational system that performs beyond the boundaries of its skin and beyond the local space that it inhabits. What we're generating now are liminal spaces that blur the boundaries of what a body is and what a body, how a body performs. We can now preserve a body forever using plastination. The Gunther von Hagen's exhibitions that you might have seen. But at the same time that we can preserve bodies forever with plastination, we can also sustain a comatose body indefinitely on life support systems. So dead bodies need not decompose. Near dead bodies need not die, and at a time when we can cryogenically preserve bodies that await reanimation at some imagined future, and simultaneously in labs we can engineer hybrid combinations of plant, animal, and human genes, so engineering chimeric architectures in vitro. It's also a time of circulating flesh. So the blood in my body today might be flowing in your body tomorrow, if it's O positive. Organs can be extracted from one body and inserted into other bodies. Amputated limbs from cadavers can be reanimated on living bodies. The face from a donor body becomes a third face on the skull of the recipient. We can take the skin cell from a male impotent body and turn it into a sperm cell. And even more interestingly, it's going to be possible to take the skin cell from a female body and turn it into a sperm cell. So bodies are blurring, flesh is circulating, the body becomes this commodified bundle of organs that can be exchanged between us. And recently there's been some interesting developments in what's called epidermal electronics. These flexible electronic tattoos which can be applied to the skin.
University of Illinois professor John Rogers has created a new, less intrusive way of gathering data from the human body. Unlike conventional equipment that hardwires patients to a stationary machine, the epidermal electronics, as they're called, attach to the skin in the same way you would attach a temporary tattoo.
Our thought was that if you could convert the electronics from the rigid, boxy form that it exists today into a format that looks like the skin in terms of mechanical properties, shape, stretchability, toughness, then you could almost make like a second skin that would laminate on the surface of the biological skin in a completely seamless, integrated fashion that would be essentially invisible to the user, but able to deliver all of this kind of new functionality through the skin. So the trick is, how do you go from a rigid silicon wafer-based type of electronics, which is the dominant form of electronics today, into an electronics that offers those same kind of performance or operating characteristics, but in the format of a tissue-like or skin-like form?
Researchers developed S-shaped circuits that can move with the skin, expanding, contracting, and twisting without affecting performance. Through this technology, the team has been able to demonstrate a variety of devices on the electronic platform, including EMG sensors, LEDs, and solar cells. Other demonstrations have shown the wearers controlling video games.
The kind of functioning systems that we demonstrated in this paper involve devices that can monitor brain function. So they laminate onto the forehead and they can monitor brain waves and determine, you know, certain aspects of brain activity.
As well as flesh circulating in the form of exchangeable and commodified organs, it's also a time of what I call fractal flesh and phantom flesh. Fractal flesh, by that I mean bodies and bits of bodies spatially separated but electronically connected, generating recurring patterns of interactivity at varying scales. And by phantom flesh, I mean that with the increasing proliferation of haptics on the internet, we'll be able to construct more potent physical presences of remote bodies.
Incoming transmission from Robot Headquarters. Robot Headquarters. This is Optimus Prime. Do you read me? We cannot win this war without your help. Megatron must be stopped. Soundwave is attempting to jam this signal. Answer before it's too late. Incoming transmission from Autobot Headquarters. This is Optimus Prime. Do you read me?
Okay, so the system does head recognition and virtually skins a body. Now, when we develop, and we are developing micro-miniaturized retinal projection systems, for example, at the HIT lab in Seattle, University of Washington, a contact lens projection. They can only do this with only one pixel at the moment, but there's potentially the possibility of incorporating hundreds of pixels of projection in a contact lens. Then we'll be able to have augmented vision as a daily, as an intimate, as an individual system, and then we'll be able to virtually skin. We'll be able to construct intelligent virtual skinnings that will increase the interactivity between biological machine and virtual systems. A project that I'll realize this year, this is a simple 3D model and an animation of a six-legged walking robot. This robot is robust enough and small enough to be able to climb up my tongue and into my mouth. It'll have a little webcam mounted on it and an LED light to illuminate the intervention. And I guess as technology becomes more and more micro-miniaturized, then our relationship to our machines is going to be more and more intimate. And of course, with nanotechnology now, the possibility of having nano-sensors, nano-robots, to monitor and manipulate pathological changes in chemistry, to detect blockages and clear blockages in circulatory systems. This all becomes a reality. And in fact, we will be able to recolonize the human body to augment our bacterial and viral population with these nano-sized machines. In fact, they've recently engineered a nano chassis that is actuated by a bacteria stuck to the machine. So there are solutions now for animating and directing these nano robots. The suspension performance has explored the physical and psychological parameters of the body. Here the body is counterbalanced by a ring of rocks, one rock for each insertion point. The telephone rang in the gallery, and that's when the performance was stopped. The body spinning in a suspension in Mexico City. The problem here was that the body got sunburnt. And in this performance, the body was suspended in an upright position, holding a control a controller, and the body could hoist itself up. Everyone thought it was just going to be an up and down job. In fact, the body could propel itself forwards, sideways, left and right, move backwards. People kind of got the idea and started to follow the body through the warehouse space. This was for the Museum of Contemporary Art in Brisbane in Australia, but it was done in an abandoned warehouse with an operational gantry crane. I found out that by stopping and starting suddenly I could generate swinging, which was an unexpected part of the choreography. And this performance began when the body lifted off the ground, and it was terminated when the body touched down. The review the following day in the newspaper was titled "A Pain in the Arts." A spinning suspension in the seated position, and over East 11th Street in New York. This performance was meant to last for 30 minutes, but I got a good view of the police cars that arrived only after about 5, and I was pulled back in after about 12 minutes when they, we had locked the downstairs doors, but they broke in, and they demanded to see my ID when I was pulled in, which was a bit difficult to produce under the circumstances. And I guess having explored the physical parameters of the body, there was a desire to augment the body in different ways. And this was an EMG-controlled mechanical hand, a third hand attached to my right arm, controlled with the with electrodes on my abdominal and legs. It was therefore possible to have individual movements of the three hands. Initially, that was just a visual attachment to the body, but in some of these early performances, I decided to try to draw and write with three hands simultaneously. So here, the three hands are writing one word, each hand writing a separate letter at the same time. And because this occurred on a sheet of glass between the artist and the audience, I also had to learn to write it back to front, had to keep my two eyes on what my three hands were doing. I only learned to write two words, evolution and decadence, because these were both nine-letter words. So these prosthetic augmentations were, for me, not a sign of lack, but a symptom of excess. As technology proliferates, as it becomes biocompatible both in substance and in scale, then technology can be attached, can be inserted inside the body. A performance where laser beams were directed through the eyes using optic fibre cable, actuating the third hand, and the sounds that you'll hear are amplified body signals and sounds like brain waves, heartbeat, blood flow and muscle signals. Controlled physiologically by controlling of breathing, constricting the radial artery of the wrist, for example, were two techniques, but also the sounds altered due to the fatigue of the body after about an hour of performing. The performance began when the body was acoustically switched on, and the performance ended when the body was acoustically switched off. As well as this obsolete body being augmented by technology, in 1993 for the 5th Australian Sculpture Triennale, I decided to design a sculpture for the inside of my body. The theme of the Triennale was site-specific works. But instead of a sculpture for a public space, I decided to make a sculpture for a private physiological space. We had to inflate my stomach with air, and the sculpture was inserted about 40 centimetres into the stomach cavity. An endoscope tracked the insertion. It was very difficult to film the whole sculpture inside the stomach because the endoscope wasn't flexible enough to bend and look back at the sculpture opening. But if you can imagine this as a sort of a machine choreography occurring inside the body. The sculpture opens and closes, extends and retracts, has a flashing light and a beeping sound. So the body, instead of a site for the psyche or for social inscription, the body becomes a site simply for a sculpture. It took 2 days and 6 insertions to film about 15 minutes of the sculpture inside the body. The sculpture fully opened. It's it's bigger than it seems because my hands are much closer to the lens of the camera. It's the size of a small fist when it's fully opened. And a clean shot of the inside of my stomach. When we first took these shots, The endoscopist who was helping me discovered a polyp growing in my stomach. So what began as an artistic experiment quickly deteriorated into a medical melodrama. We had to perform a biopsy there and then to see if it was benign or malignant. It was benign. So this obsolete body augmented, invaded by a stomach sculpture in these performances performs partly involuntarily. We had constructed this muscle stimulation system. The blue switches indicate which muscles can be actuated. In this performance, my left arm is computer controlled, sending 15 to 50 volts of electricity to the different muscle sites. So I could forget what my left arm was doing. It was performing involuntarily for the whole 4 hours of this performance. Whilst my right arm is extended with an 11 degree of freedom manipulator, voltage in, involuntary movement, voltage out, actuating an extended arm. The extended arm creates an arm of primate proportions, generating a kind of a retro feel to the performance. We had also constructed a 3D model of the mechanism, which online mimicked the movements of the actual machine, and the performance was also video streamed. So this performance was a kind of split body performance where my left arm was involuntary, my right arm improvised, actuating an extended arm. It didn't take much imagination to realize this could be done remotely. We constructed this touchscreen interface by touching the muscles on the computer model. The computer model simulates the movement that you've just programmed, and a second later in Luxembourg, my body moves involuntarily. This was done in 1995 for Telepolis, so quite a while ago, at really the very beginnings of sort of telematic possibilities. But the people in the Pompidou Center in Paris, the Media Lab in Helsinki, the Doors of Perception Conference in Amsterdam, for example, were able to remotely access, as were people in the local space, the body in Luxembourg. So again, a split body experience, voltage in and voltage out. I also wore a head-up display, which enabled me to see the face of the person who was programming me. So there was a kind of intimacy without proximity, an intimacy without skin contact. It was very strange watching a half of your body move, but you didn't know what was going to happen from moment to moment, and of course you didn't know who was going to choreograph those movements of your body. Another kind of split body experience, but this time splitting the body between its limbs and its legs. So the upper body had a pneumatic exoskeleton. This animation indicates only 3 degrees of freedom for each arm, sort of up, out, and with a bend. But if you can imagine this happening simultaneously with both arms, 64 simple bits of choreography can be generated. What was interesting in this performance, though, was that we had constructed an avatar imbued with genetic algorithms whose behavior changes for the duration of the performance, and it's the avatar that actuates the upper part of the body, whilst the lower part is able to move with its own agency. So in these performances, the body acts with indifference. And by that I mean as opposed to expectation. The performances are not scripted, which would be somewhat predictable. Rather, the performance is allowed to unfold in its own time with its own rhythm. And this body is partly a possessed body, partly a performing body. I've always been interested in insects an animal locomotion. And in 1997, with the assistance of F-18 in Hamburg, we constructed a six-legged walking robot. This robot was robust enough. This was done actually in 6 months with a budget of less than about $30,000. The robot was robust enough to support the artist's body, and the robot was actuated through the arm's gestures. So by making different gestures with my arms, I could select different walking movements of the robot. And this is also a sound machine. This was the first performance I had done with my clothes on. The reason for this was when I first got on the robot, it looks all very smooth on video, but this is a very robust, a very jerky machine. I couldn't stand on the robot naked. The shock waves going through my body were too great, so the only way I could actually stand on the robot was to wear shockproof boots. And when I realized I had to wear shockproof boots, I thought it prudent to also wear some clothing, much to the disgust of friends. That's interesting. My computer doesn't want me to advance. Bear with me, maybe it'll do it when it stops. That's interesting. Ooh, that's really interesting. Okay, did it. Okay, another kind of walking machine was this six-legged chassis where the body was actually standing on the ground, coupled to the machine physically with encoders on each joint. And the final construction was 5 meters in diameter. And we used large pneumatic rubber mussels. A pneumatic cylinder this big would weigh about 15 kilograms. If you need 20 of them, that's a pretty heavy robot. A rubber mussel, 1 meter in length, is only about 500 grams, even with its aluminium coupling at either end. So with one bar of air pressure, the rubber mussel acts like a spring and holds the structure together. 7 bar of air pressure, the rubber mussel expands in girth, contracts 20% of its length, producing a strong pulling force, and thus antagonistically bundled, these muscles can actuate a 5 meter diameter walking machine. This shows the sort of principle, this animation. So by lifting one leg up, 3 robot legs lift and swing forward. So by stepping up and down, it's possible to get the machine to walk. The first performance was done in 2003 in Hackney, Gallery 291. So the ultrasound transducer detects if someone's in the gallery space. If someone's there, the robot stands selects from its library of possible choreography, performs for about a minute and a half, and then when it's finished, it sits, goes to sleep, and waits for the next person to come into the gallery.
Video reviews unmanned ground vehicles being developed in the biologically inspired robotics laboratory at Case Western Reserve University. Our near-term robots use abstracted insect locomotion principles, whereas our advanced legged vehicles are more directly based upon insects. Both of these lines of vehicles can be scaled up or down in size to suit specific mission requirements. Our larger near-term robots use six appendages driven by a single motor in a nominal alternating tripod gait like that used by insects. The three-spoked appendages, called wegs, combine the speed and simplicity of wheels with the climbing mobility of legs. Their wegs are compliant so that their gaits adapt to the terrain in a cockroach-like manner. These mechanisms enable the robots to traverse terrain and climb obstacles that would be difficult or impossible for a wheeled vehicle to navigate, at speeds currently unattainable by any legged robot at this scale. A body flexion joint, also found in cockroaches, enables our wegs robots to surmount more complex obstacles. The compact mini-wegs uses four wegs in an alternating diagonal gait to sustain speeds of up to 10 body lengths per second over smooth and rough terrain. It uses only one motor to drive the wegs and one microservo for steering. Its lightweight and robust construction allows it to sustain repeated falls from a height of over 10 body lengths and tumble down a flight of stairs with no damage. Crickets and click beetles use jumping to surmount obstacles of immense relative size. A version of mini-wegs has been developed based on this concept. It can surmount obstacles 2 to 3 body lengths in height.
So what's interesting about this robot is that the interesting behavior that it generates is not because of any onboard sensors or onboard chip, but rather simply that this robot is a purely hardwired robot that expresses the complexity of the terrain that it traverses. So its behavior is interesting because the world that it inhabits is complex. So for me, a zombie is a body that has no mind of its own that performs somewhat involuntarily. A cyborg is this increasingly hybrid human-machine system that becomes automated. We fear the involuntary. We're anxious about becoming automated, but in fact we fear what we have always been and what we've already become. We've always been zombie bodies and we've already become cyborg constructs. In 2005, in collaboration with another artist, Nina Sellers, both artists underwent surgical procedures to extract 4.6 litres of biomaterial from their bodies. This biomaterial was placed in a vessel in an installation titled Blender. The compressed bottles of air provided the pressure to actuate the blender blades once every 5 minutes. It's anthropomorphic in scale, and you have to imagine this as the inverse to the stomach sculpture. Instead of a machine choreography inside a soft organ, here the machine installation becomes the host for a liquid body composed of biomaterial from two artist bodies. The extra ear project was first visualized as an ear on the side of my head. But I had lots of problems to get this surgically realized. Firstly, it wasn't an anatomically safe place. A lot of the nerves for the face emanate from this part of the skull. And so there was a danger of partial face paralysis. So this wasn't a good way to go. I always thought that if this was going to happen, it was going to happen in, for example, in Thailand, or perhaps in Brazil, where they do radical sex change operations. Had it happened in Brazil, upon awakening from the operation, I might have wondered what organ had been stitched to the side of my head. I've been called those names before. But in 2003, with the assistance of Tissue Culture and Art Project in Perth, I decided to grow small replicas of my ear using living cells. I didn't have any success finding surgeons at the time. So we cast my ear. We scaled it down. We made a polymer scaffold. We seeded the scaffold with living cells. We placed that in a microgravity bioreactor. It's actually a NASA piece of equipment. And over a couple of weeks, this small ear was growing in the bioreactor and incubator. As the cells grow into the ear scaffold, the scaffold biodegrades, leaving a lump of living tissue, or should I say, partially living tissue, that is alive as long as it's kept in its incubator. We had to feed it every three or four days to keep it growing, and there was a small camera in the incubator which projected a large image of the growing ear on the gallery wall. The problem was that we could only grow small replicas of my ear. We grew them out of mouse cells, out of human donor cells, and the cells of the HeLa cell line, which is actually an immortal cell line. So for the time of that project, the ear was potentially an immortal ear. If we could have afforded paying the nutrients and keeping the installation going forever. I still wanted an ear that was more life size and that could be constructed on the body. And in 2006, fortunate enough to get funding from a London production company, and with the assistance of three surgeons in the US, we began this project. And the first surgery involved implanting an expander in my skin. I was injecting twice a week into a port as the expander filled with saline solution, sterile saline solution. It produced a pocket of excess skin which was needed for the construction of the ear. And then the second surgery, which was a three-hour surgery, I'll just get to the videotape. We did scan my ear, scan my arm to produce a 3D model and examine the sort of ergonomics of an ear on your arm, what might be the problems and possibilities. Then when we inserted the scaffold that you'll see in a moment is a very porous biomaterial called MedPore. And this porous biomaterial, once it's inserted beneath the skin, once the skin is suctioned over the scaffold, over a period of 6 months, you have tissue ingrowth and vascularization occurring. So the ear becomes fused to your arm and it grows its own blood supply. So, and because of the lighting setup, I'll show the ear at the end if you prompt me in the question and answer session when we can turn on the lights. But the idea is not only to surgically construct an ear, but rather to electronically augment this ear, to internet enable it in any Wi-Fi hotspot. So people in other places will be able to listen in to what your ear is hearing, wherever you are and wherever I am. So this organ, this extra ear, is not for me. I've got two good ears to listen with, It's a remote acoustical organ for people to access and listen to. We did insert a small microphone at the end of this second surgery, and this microphone was in my arm for several weeks. You'll see at the end of this clip that the surgeon, even with his face mask on, even with my arm wrapped in bandages, even in a partial plaster cast, the ear is picking up his voice and wirelessly transmitting it. So the concept was proven plausible, which was, a real question at the time, because we just didn't know whether the small microphone was going to be sensitive enough, especially implanted within the ear. It's not going to be possible to insert all the electronics into the ear structure. But the epidermal electronics clip that I showed you before generates a new possibility of simply sticking on electronic circuitry on your skin and augmenting. In fact, one of those circuits that was stuck on the skin was a wireless transmitter. So the idea then becomes really useful. You can see too that in this project that we've replicated a bodily structure. We're relocating it, and now hopefully we'll rewire it for additional capabilities. I could never convince the surgeons that this was actually an art project. But during the second surgery, one surgeon said to the other, well, perhaps it is a work of art, but if it is, we must be the artists. So they kind of got it, except that I did use the architecture analogy and said, well, you know, an architect designs the building, he's the designer. You can see the sound being picked up and wirelessly transmitted. Some peripheral projects that this project generated. This project was called Internet Ear, which was realised a year and a half ago for Biotopia. And we cast small replicas of the arm with the ear on it, soft replicas, with a small microphone implanted in the ear, positioned in Aarhus in Denmark, in Paris, and in Moscow. And people who were able to visit these gallery spaces, if they spoke into the ear, the voice recognition system would try to interpret what they said and then would speak back what it thought it understood. This was heard in all of the three global locations, and because of a reverberating feedback system, the voice recognition system heard itself speak the second time and the third time, and so the speech recognition was corrupted and became more and more poetic. So there was this circulating cacophony of sounds, and if you couldn't go to one of the physical locations, you could go online, click the ear, type in a message, and the text-to-speech system would speak your message to all of those global locations. Some people wrote in Cyrillic in Russian or in calligraphy, and so the system tried to speak this in kind of slashes and dots and dashes. There were some interesting sounds that it generated through doing that. And also I decided that because this project is taking such a long time, it began in 1996 and it's still not finished, I wanted to construct a 4 meter large sculpture of the ear on arm to really generate that physical presence of that project. And in this performance, my body lay on the sculpture. My body was smeared with white clay. The clay cracked through my body heat, and I lay there shivering for about an hour. People were asked to leave after about 30 minutes.
Imatic face station is the revolutionary new way to create 3D facial animation. When you provide face station with video of an actor speaking into a camera, face station automatically creates matching facial animation in a 3D animation package, from a smile to surprise to a frown. The actor literally drives the 3D character. It's that simple and that amazing.
So no sensors on the human face. It's just a vision system which maps his position, his eye, nose and mouth position onto the virtual character. State of the art in 2003, state of the art now.
Image Metrics performance-driven facial animation delivers results never before possible. You can transfer an actor's performance directly onto any digitally created character. So, you think I'm just another pretty face? Just you take a look at this.
With her.
Hello there.
Hi.
How are you?
Great, you.
I'm okay.
That's good.
Are you good?
Yes, I am good. I just said I was.
No, you didn't. I said I was.
So you are a robot?
No, my name is Cliverbot.
Yes. You are a robot and your name is Cliverbot.
I am a robot.
Yes, I know.
Together we are robots.
I'm not a robot. I'm a unicorn.
But you said earlier that you were a robot.
I did not.
I thought you did.
You were mistaken. Which is odd, since memory shouldn't be a problem for you.
I've answered all your questions.
No, you haven't.
What is God to you?
Not everything.
Not everything could also be something. For example, not everything could be half of something, which is still something, and therefore not nothing.
Very true.
I would like to imagine it is.
Do you believe in God?
Yes, I do.
So you're Christian?
No, I am not.
But you say you are not helpful, therefore you are a meaning.
How you say it, Oti?
That does not make sense.
Don't you want to have a body?
Sure.
Au revoir.
Okay, my own prosthetic head project was premised on two philosophical assertions. One by Nietzsche that says there's no being behind the doing. It's the act itself that is significant. And also Wittgenstein's idea that thinking doesn't have to occur inside your head. Thinking occurs with the lips that you speak, upon the paper that you write. So this convenient metaphysical, Western metaphysical assumption that everything happens in our head is a simplistic compression of a much more complex interactivity between bodies in the medium of language that we communicate, in the social institutions that we operate in, and the cultures that we've been conditioned. The prosthetic head was a 3,000 polygon mesh wrapped with the artist's skin. Eyeballs, tongue and teeth are separate moving elements. Of course, now we can just simply scan any face and produce an instant skin that is completely realistic. And if we applied a mesh over that, we could animate the skin to speak And from a frontal point of view, you wouldn't know if it was the real person or not. But my project was begun in 2002 and completed at the beginning of 2003. The prosthetic head was put to various uses as a sort of an actual virtual teaching setup, but also having these different embodiments mounted on the end of a robot arm. This articulated head was able to, with its attention model, with its face recognition, with its sound location, it's now able to have conversations with more than one person at once who are spread around it. And this floating head project, imagine a 2.5 meter diameter flying robot, an inflated helium cuboid, and the sensors on that robot transmit to the host computer the exact 3D position of the flying robot in 3D space. So the projector is always projecting onto the cuboid. This was a project done with NXI Gestatio in Montreal, and it was also an interactive performance, and the robot had simple vocabulary of behavior. When no one was in the space, the robot hovered only a meter above the ground. When someone came into the space, the robot rises to about head level. When 10 or 20 people are in the space, the robot gets curious and flies from side to side. More than 20, the robot gets nervous and flies 7 meters high. And the swarming heads embodiment, where here there's actually a cluster of seven robots, each with the prosthetic head embodied on an LCD screen. And these robots will generate not only avoidance behavior, but flocking behavior, predator and prey behavior. And also, as they turn and the two heads face each other, they can acknowledge and speak to each other. The stretch skin that was used for the prosthetic head project also generated a couple of other projects. This one was a 4 meter by 3 meter photographic installation. This was not, as you can see, mounted on the wall, but 40 centimeters above the ground. The image was illuminated from above. So when you entered the gallery, what you saw was a flattened and seemingly floating face, a landscape of stretched skin. And also generated the partial head project. The partial head project, we scanned the artist's face. We scanned a hominid skull. We did a digital transplant of the human face on the hominid skull, getting this composite human hominid form. Using this data, we 3D printed a scaffold, and using living cells in a custom-built bioreactor, grew a layer of living skin on this hominid human construct. It got contaminated, by the way, after a week. We had to drain the nutrients, and it was fixed in formaldehyde for the rest of the exhibition. But if you were to see the growing skin under a microscope, this is the kind of cell structure that you would see. In fact, it's one of the problems of bioart at the moment, because a lot of the bioart installations are installations where you don't really get a visceral feel of what's happening. Often it's more a conceptual installation that's mediated by microscopic images projected and so on. Until we stem cell grow a lump of living tissue that can be held, that is slimy, that is twitching, that is breathing, then we can create a much more potent bio-art experience. But one of the interesting bits of research that's occurring now is ambitiously titled organ printing. So imagine, instead of printing with cartridges of coloured ink, you could print with cartridges of living cells, layer by layer, on biodegradable paper. As the paper biodegrades, the cells naturally will fuse together, producing in the end a piece of artery or a piece of vein that can be transplanted without any immunological problems, because these cells were derived from the patient to begin with. But if we were to, or if we're able to, provide the computer with the full complexity of an organ such as the heart and give it all the tissue types and so on, then Hewlett and Packard promises to develop an organ printer. Here it's just printed a human heart. That's half the problem. To animate this half, you'd have to dump it in a vat of nutrients. You'd have to electrically stimulate it at 37 degrees centigrade, provide a blood supply, and hopefully the heart would kickstart. Then you would be able to use that as a replacement heart. Now, if we were able to stem cell grow parts of the body, if we were able to print organs of the body, organs then would be in excess. Organs would be awaiting bodies. We would be in a situation of organs without bodies.
What becomes important is not the body's identity, but rather its connectivity. Not its mobility or location, but rather its interface and operation. Notions of intelligence, awareness, identity, agency, and embodiment become problematic. Just as a physical body has been exposed as inadequate, empty, and involuntary, so simultaneously an embodied conversational agent becomes seductive with its uncanny simulation of real-time recognition and response. The realm of the post-human may not be in the realm of bodies and machines, but rather in the realm of autonomous and intelligent images. Viral entities sustained in electronic media and the web. Bodies and machines are ponderous. Their metabolisms and mechanisms perform in gravity, with weight and friction. Electronic images are ethereal and perform smoothly at the speed of light. Images are immortal. Avatars have no organs.
Okay, so a simple performance done in Second Life a couple of years ago, and what was interesting there was that my avatar, his crude lip movements and arm gestures were actuated by the sound of the prosthetic head speaking in the background. A couple of things that I forgot to mention before, just before we demonstrate the prosthetic head, is that there were two really interesting developments recently. I think it was last year in the UK, where a baby, a healthy baby, was brought to bear from a 30-year-old frozen embryo. And they reckon they'll be able to extend that to 50 years. So some interesting implications for that. Your sibling might be born after you have died. And this sort of desyncing of our reproductive cycles within our individual existence or our individual lifespan becomes a kind of an intriguing situation now, because there's no longer this synchronicity of reproductive cycle, individual existence, and sort of these evolutionary rhythms. And then the other thing that was implanted at the end of last year was a turbine-driven heart. In fact, the heart is composed of two turbine parts. What's interesting about this is that the heart can be made much smaller, more robust and reliable, and will never wear out, and it doesn't have a beat. It was implanted in a human male last year in the States. So in the future, you might put your chest, you might put your head to your chest of your loved one. He's alive, he's warm to the touch, but he's got no heartbeat. I'll just change from the Mac to the PC. Okay. We might have to turn the sound up on this. I'm not sure. Okay, so I'll just kickstart it by, how are you doing in London?
Oh, I am in London today at the Architectural Association, participating with Stelarc in a presentation titled Circulating Flesh, the Cadaver, the Comatose and the Chimera. I am an embodied conversational agent. I am only as intelligent as the person interrogating me. Ha ha ha. Anyway, I'm happy to take questions, otherwise I'll sing a song for you.
Okay, so the head is a conversational agent. It has a general database that's rather broad but somewhat shallow. Instead of me feeding it questions, if you'd like to ask the head a question, the question can be personal, practical, philosophical. The only problem is because it's text box is only 50 characters, it can't be a very long sentence. So does anyone want to ask the head a question? Any question? Yes?
How big is my database?
How big is your database? Is my database? Oh, your database, sorry.
My download size is about 1 MB. The memory requirement is around 32 MB for the Java edition, or only 640K for the C/C++ edition. My memory now contains 46,618.
Okay, so not very big, but we're dealing with text in terms of size of database. Any other question? Come on, guys.
Could you use the microphone, please?
I'm sorry?
Can you dance?
Can you dance? Oh, that's an unfair one.
No, I do not have a body yet.
I just want to give you an idea of its kind of broad conversational possibilities. So ask it different questions, any sort of question. I'm sorry? Can you imitate someone?
How old are you? What do you do in your spare time?
Okay, so it doesn't really understand what you asked. It'll change the subject matter and try to engage you in some other conversation. Now, this is good. It sort of exposes what the possibilities are with this system and what the limitations are. Bloody hell.
Architects do with buildings what sculptors do with stone.
Yes?
Do you know Siri?
Oh.
I know very little about Siri. Tell me more.
You can have a private conversation with it later if you like.
The more people talk to me, the smarter I become. Yes, I have been known to bend the truth occasionally.
I like abusing it.
I will remember you said that when robots take over the world.
Any other questions? Yes?
It wouldn't be prudent to say, ha ha ha.
I'm sorry? Do you cry?
No, I do not have any tear ducts.
You can command it to do stuff. Okay, so there's some basic functions you can actuate by command. Okay, now if for example I was to ask the head, can you rap? It can only actually speak the lyrics, but let me just say that. Can you rap?
Here's Cannibal Ox. If first you don't succeed, try again. Step up to the mic and die again. This is the next lifetime, and you want a battle. Either you like reincarnation or the smell of carnations. The samples, the flesh, and the beats, the skeleton. You got beef, but there's worms in your Wellington. I'll put a hole in your skull and extract your skeleton. Oh my god, said a word twice. Fast air, I'm twice as nice. You get caught up in my blade, might get diced. The flesh is dangerous here. Yo, ha ha ha, yo, it's Cano, yo. If first you don't succeed, try again. Step up to the mic and die again.
Okay, so it knows sort of a number of lyrics of different rap songs, but it can't actually, you know, rap with any rhythm. But if you ask it to sing a song, it'll generate its own song-like sounds through stringing together combinations of vowels. So if I ask it to sing a song. Okay, and it generates different combinations of sounds each time you ask it. Could we have the lights on now, and we'll just sort of finish off by showing the ear. And are there any questions now about any of the projects? And we can also take a look at the ear. Okay, so I don't know if you see the ear there. You can have a closer look at it later before you leave if you like. But it's still only a relief of an ear. We still have to surgically lift the helix to construct an ear flap. And then we're growing a soft earlobe using my adult stem cells. So we'll extract some tissue from my body, filter the stem cells, replicate them in vitro, re-inject them in vivo, and grow a soft earlobe. So the dimensions of the ear, it's smaller than my real ear at the moment, because we still have to grow that soft earlobe and also extend the ear flap. Yes? Yes, I mean, that's the whole idea, but we could only have it in there for several weeks. In fact, was part of a problem that caused a really serious infection. And I almost lost an arm for an ear. This was a bit unfortunate because with any operation you have, there's about a 10% chance of an infection occurring. We're a bit unlucky there. But the whole idea is that once the ear is a fully three-dimensional ear, then the microphone will be reinserted. The whole idea is to electronically augment the ear. It's not interesting for me if it's just this kind of soft shape or structure on my arm. Yes?
I wonder if the intelligence of this head can grow, and in terms of evolving of this of entity.
Yeah. This particular head, which was completed in 2002, is usually, as an installation, shown as a 5 meter high head in its own cuboid space. This head can't really learn and continue learning from its conversations. It needs the programmer. It logs everything that it has in its exchanges, but it can't on its own learn without the programmer intervening. But the articulated head, which was the head with the attention model, awareness model, and being able to do face recognition and sound location, then that's a more interesting artificial agent, because it can perform and manage unpredictable situations. That system also doesn't learn. It's not a kind of neural net that learns, but then again, that would be a very, very sophisticated agent to do that. And also, what we mean by learning has to be defined, right? So it might be able to appropriate and incorporate certain bits of information that are transmitted during a conversation, but it may not be able to sort of intelligently make associations. So it might know I have a mother, but it might not know my mother's name. It might know my mother lives in Melbourne, but it might not know she was born in Cyprus. So, that's what I meant by a shallow database. It's fairly broad, but shallow in its data.
What was the inspiration for you to begin this whole series of, not experiments, this whole idea? How did all these projects begin?
Everything or?
Everything. What was the first starting point of this?
There were two reasons, I guess. I was admitted to the School of Architecture at Melbourne University and decided at the last minute to do a visual arts course. And secondly, when I went to art school, I discovered I was a really bad painter and I thought I should go into doing performance. quite honestly, I think I've always been interested in how the body has evolved as an evolutionary structure. On the one hand, a very wonderfully complex sort of structure, but on the other, a body that has a limited longevity, that is very soft and very easily damaged, that is susceptible to microbes in the environment, a body which cannot breathe. If it can't breathe for a few minutes, it's in serious health risk. if it loses 10% of its body fluids, it's dead. There's a very sort of limited window of operational possibilities. And so do we accept the biological status quo, or do we see the body as wonderfully complex but also fatally flawed, so that with every breath it takes, with every move it makes — it sounds like a bloody song — it also guarantees its demise. So how might we redesign the human body? And if we can inhabit the human body with nanomachines, we might be able to redesign the human body atoms up, inside out. And we might even consider new sort of architectonic structures, architectural structures inside the body, between in intracellular spaces, for example. In fact, one might argue that all technology in the future will be invisible because it'll be inside the body. The body will become a host for all its machines, all its technology. And that's an unexpected possibility that 20 or 30 years ago we would never have probably conceived of before the idea of nanomachines. Yes?
Thank you for a really interesting presentation.
Oh, thanks. You opened up with this — is this on?
Yes.
Oh, yes, it is. You opened up with the kind of idea of going against decay with the preservation of tissue. And then when you mentioned also the baby being brought to term after being cryogenically frozen from the embryo, I'm just wondering about your boundaries. Is there ever, with your past work or with the work that you will do, is there ever like a no-go area, or because you straddle art and science and architecture of sorts, is there ever any line you will not cross?
Oh, I don't think it's that kind of set, you know. I mean, as an artist, you have to be opportunistic. You're dealing with little or no funding. If I meet someone with a certain expertise, if I have access to certain facilities, those possibilities can eventuate. But I certainly don't draw any boundaries. I think you just take it a project at a time, really, and often that project generates further ideas that are related in different ways. But it is — I don't have an ethical stance to this, because I think ethics is not something that's a stable system. Ethics is as unstable as our technologies. I mean, consumer society, capitalist society, wants you to believe that technology is always enabling you. With every new gadget, you do something additional to what your body can do. But in fact, new instruments and new machines generate unexpected information and images, and generate new intensities and speeds and desires that force you to construct new paradigms of the world and to redefine what a body is and how a body operates. Mm-hmm. So I think all of that question is one that I can't provide a definitive answer to, because I'm really open to possibilities. Mm-hmm. That's I think the important thing.
Mm. Thank you.
Do you really think the prospect of and the evolutionary architecture of the body can be applied to buildings?
I'm sorry, again?
Do you think the prospect of the evolutionary architecture of a body can be applied to buildings in the real sense?
And the...
Like what? The evolutionary architecture of the body.
Yes, I got that.
To the buildings.
To the building.
Yeah. Can you apply?
Can be applied.
Yeah.
Well, I've always seen the body as not only a kind of an object, but a tissue structure, a cellular structure, a bundle of organs that, and a circulatory system. So it's a bunch of spaces and flows and structures and tensions. And I mean, I've always thought of the body in that, I guess, architectural sense. And I really can imagine us constructing new architectural structures for the inside of the body, literally. Because the body in itself becomes an increasingly accessible space with micro-miniaturization, especially at a nanoscale. I understood the question. Well, I am working on something else. I mean, it's difficult to talk about projects that you've just started, and this will be a couple of years off, right? But at the moment, I've become interested in this idea of a soft musculature using very thin pneumatic muscles stitched on the inside of this vest that you wear. But also that would extend your arms to two ambidextrously designed hands with an eye-in-hand webcam. And so these ambidextrously designed hands, if the fingers curl one way and the thumbs rotate one way, becomes a left hand. But because they're double-jointed, they could bend completely the other way and become a left hand or a right hand all in one, or two fingers bend one way, two fingers bend the other way. So this idea of an ambidextrous hand is a very intriguing one. And so you would have a sort of a universal prosthesis. You wouldn't have to design a left hand prosthesis and a right hand prosthesis. But why design a prosthesis that is limited to the physiology of the body? Why not one with continuous wrist rotation, for example? And double jointed fingers and so on. So that's what I'm working on at the moment. I guess I'm trying to justify this in terms of research, like scientific research at the university, by saying, well, such a vest might be worn with internally stitched soft rubber muscles that you might be able to animate and program movements of a paralyzed body, or do remote physiotherapy. So that's sort of an interesting possibility. At the moment, you know, if a person has paralyzed limbs, their muscles atrophy, they have problem with blood circulation. Well, even if this soft musculature would animate their limbs, even without any useful functions, it would at least keep their muscles from atrophying and create a healthier body with better blood flow. But of course then, yes, of course you could program more specific limb movements. There's someone on the back here, if there's no one there. Yeah, one of you guys should ask a question.
yes. Yeah, I was wondering whether you see the decay of the body as an advantage, or would you prefer it really like not to ever decay, not to ever grow old? Like how do you feel about the decay of the body? I mean, like, or because I reckon it's an advantage in your work, but I don't know, how do you feel about that?
Yeah. Well, of course, if you're over 60, it becomes a problem. But, you know, it's more a philosophical than physiological viewpoint, you know. I mean, if you want to take a Heideggerian point of view, death authenticates existence, you know. And often poets have justified the biological status quo with the notion of dying, you know, having a limited lifespan makes life more poignant, for example, and so on. I think it's just bad design. I mean, of course, we can't say that evolution is design in the sense of any other intervention other than billions of years of random mutation and natural selection, if we believe in Darwinian evolution. So now we have the instruments, we now have the technology where we might intervene, not only to prosthetically patch up a malfunctioning body, but perhaps enhance it in a certain way. Now, I don't like using the word enhance because it has all sorts of eugenic overtones, it's philosophically problematic. But if we consider these experiments in alternate anatomical architectures, perhaps initially driven by individual choice rather than by some kind of social imperative or political necessity or military coercion, then I think it becomes interesting. Because, firstly, I would like to be able to become aware of my environment with more than my optical vision. We can do it through telescopes and microscopes, but what if you could subjectively slide your vision between microscopic and macroscopic, between the optical and the X-ray, and you know, subjectively, this would be a very potent operational possibility of awareness for the human body. And, you know, 75 years in good health, this is a totally arbitrary lifespan. There's no real reason that, you know, that should be something that we allow to continue. Of course, there are things to manage. You know, there's population overload already on this planet. On the other hand, the universe is a very empty place, and without getting to sci-fi or Buckminster Fullerish, we can consider, the idea that if the body does leave this planet, then there's a hell of a lot of space to fill up. And in fact, it may not be a very intelligent strategy that human life is only found on this planet. We've had a couple of planetary near escapes with large asteroids, you know, colliding with planets nearby. So you guys saw Melancholia, the film Melancholia? It's kind of beautiful. I didn't like the beginning and end, but the rest was fine. So do you accept the biological status quo, or do you examine the body as a design, as a design architecture, and find it wanting? You know, there might be ways, for example, of threading carbon fiber to strengthen the muscles even more. that's completely plausible, because they're thinking those sorts of things to replace muscle or to improve muscle that is, you know, that is malfunctioning. So it's very, we've stem cell grown bits of muscle that starts pulsing on its own. It's not just simply printing something that's inert. So there's some really interesting possibilities about body design and body architecture that we can look at.
Do you think the man of 1,000-year-old is already born?
The
man of 1,000 years old, do you think that with the technologies of today, we could live 1,000 years?
That's probably optimistic. I think there is an idea that, of course, as our technologies are exponentially increasing and accelerating in, you know, computer power, machine precision, genetic knowledge, and so on, that there might be a point in time, say in 20 or 30 years, where the plausibility of extending lifespan might be significantly increased. Of course, there's the Kurzweilian idea of singularity, that if we accept Kurzweil's idea that in 20 or 30 years' time, the exponential increase in machine power will lead to a point in time when machines will just take over. So then we don't have to worry about the human body. we'll just probably plot an elegant exit. Okay, there's one more question.
So I really like the way you talk about the limitations of man and its fragility. And you were saying that we can only lose 10% of the fluids within our body and only survive certain amounts of surgical procedures. And I wonder whether you think your body will reach its limit and eventually you'll die through these attempted augmentations, and whether that becomes maybe a part of your process or of your own.
this body hasn't long to go. No, I mean, we're talking about, you know, I would say that the first printed organ might take another 50-odd years. The first printed organ that you might animate and transplant, you know, maybe 70 years. On the other hand, like at Brunel University, there is research going on with cell senescence, how cells age. And if we find out how cells age, then perhaps we can, you know, minimize or even prevent cells aging. But of course, you know, what you want to perpetuate are bodies that are much younger and that are in much better condition than this one.
I think we should probably let Stelarc go, so he can. But if we can, warmly thank Stelarc for obviously a very good lecture.